So then you notice a couple of things. So it peaked right at the end of the school year, at the end of June. And we're running at about 180,000 individual people each week building apps on Inventor. And so you also see a couple of things. You see we're starting to crash from the summer. And then you can go back a year and you can see that reflects the 2015 crash at the end of the school year and the 2014 crash at the end of the school year. So we're now going to go, so if history repeats, we're going to be in a trough until probably September. And the other thing you notice is this dip right there is Christmas vacation. And the dip over here a year ago is Christmas vacation. And the little dip in 2013, which is the same thing as Christmas vacation. So that tells us that there is a lot of work in App Inventor going on in schools. Although we actually don't know that from MIT. We so far have not done any work actually surveying who our users actually are. That's going to be a priority for this coming year, to really have us find out more about our users. So anyway, this has been an amazing year for App Inventor. It's an amazing time for kids in computing. And I guess I could have said that any time since the year 2000, or the year 1990, or the year 1980. But now something's happening that's really different and really special. And what I'd like to do, if you'll indulge me, is give you a very personal perspective on that, where I think we are and where I think we might be going. So I came to MIT, gosh, in 1969. I was lucky enough that one of the first people I met at MIT was Seymour Papert. Seymour is the towering figure in educational computing and education. He and Sidney Solomon, who I guess will be here later, a chance to meet your Cynthia along with Seymour, is, as far as I'm concerned, the pioneer of educational. And in 1971, Seymour wrote this memo, which I think is still the very smartest thing that's said about computers in education, teaching children thinking. And what it talked about was what this computer stuff was about. This is 1971, if you can imagine that. It was about the power of applied knowledge and the self-perception of someone as an intellectual agent. So it didn't talk about for loops and if statements and things. It talked about the sense of intellectual agency that you could get, the empowerment you can get from these machines. And what the machines were able to do is start to make abstract ideas concrete. And for those of us, Seymour and around Seymour, who were really pretty much math nerds, this was just an incredible opportunity to take the ideas that we so much loved, that were abstract, and made them concrete so that children could use them. And over the 70s, there was this meme that was a logo in the 1970s that computers were for kids. And these computers were some of the world's most powerful computers. They were at the MIT Artificial Intelligence Lab. And here we are, a bunch of wacky idealists saying that what you should do with these powerful computers is to apply them to education. Computers are for kids. And finally, 10 years later, a at the beginning of the 80s, that started to become possible through the emergence of the personal computer. So things like Apple, and we made a logo for the Apple, which came out in 1982, and that coincided with this, the first ability of ordinary people to put their hands on computers. And again, in our vision, the important thing about this was that it could be for kids. And I was going to say, even most of the people in this room are too young. But if you guys are a little bit older, I would say, gee, there are a bunch of people here who probably got their start in computing by being the pioneers in the beginning of the 80s of computing for kids with Loader. Now, at the same time, a couple of us in the ECS department here, Jerry Sussman and me, took these same ideas, these same core ideas, which, when we boiled it down, were about abstraction and about modularity, and created a very formal sort of MIT curriculum, which became the core of MIT's computer science curriculum for about the next 20 years. The real highlight on abstraction and modularity as the centerpiece of what you think about in learning about computing. So that spread enormously, eventually due to a great influential paper by Jeanette Wayne in 2006, who took effectively those early logo ideas and branded them as computational thinking. Same kind of thing that Papert had said in that 1971 paper. And Jeanette sort of put that in a form where everybody could kind of look at it and appreciate it. And that's sort of the genesis of what we call computational thinking today. And the other big development, which is of course enormously important, was Scratch under Mitch Resnick, which again took the same idea about empowerment and being an intellectual agent, and then put it in a much richer environment than you do with just driving the turtle around. And also introduced this idea of blocks program. Actually, didn't quite introduce it. It was based on some slightly earlier MIT work in Ericsson, right? Daniel doesn't know. Introduced this notion of block programming so that it sort of helped dissociate it from details about syntax and simplified mechanism. So, in something like 40 years, the idea of computers for kids went from vision of a fringe group of idealists to a major and growing force in education. But 10 years ago, something else started happening. And that was the real emergence of mobile computing, starting with the iPhone in 2007. 2008, and suddenly computing was not about math and abstract ideas or formal thinking. Computing suddenly was about stuff that's really part of our lives, that's all around us, where we go, who our friends are. Let me introduce Cynthia, just walked down. This is my introduction to Cynthia. Cynthia is, along with Seymour, I say the inventor of reasonable educational computing. So, Cynthia, glad to be here. But with mobile computing, this wasn't just about formal thinking. It wasn't just about math, it wasn't just about powerful ideas, as important as those are. It was a way of augmenting our lives. Because what we're all seeing right now is a blending of the information world with the real world. And the empowerment that Papert had begun talking about in 1969, earlier than this, 1968, was more than just empowerment of ideas. It was empowerment of things that you can actually do, that kids can actually do in the world today that make a difference. And you know the examples, right? And some of them are your examples. So there's, you know, the kids in Alabama who ride in this thing to track wild hogs. There's the kids in Moldova who are creating a crowd-sourced system so that people throughout the country can learn about water quality in various areas. There's the kids in Lagos who are creating a system so that people can find public toilets, an environment where that is a real important issue. Kids can make a real change with this technology. And that's what many of you are doing, and we want to hear more about what you're doing. But what comes next? Because I think we're moving beyond that. So if we think about what computing was like in 1969, right when Seymour and Cynthia were inventing logo, these phones, right? These phones in our pockets compared to 1969. Look, the computational power of one smartphone is compared with 1969. The computational power of one smartphone is more than all of the computing power that NASA used in monitoring the moon landings in 1969. Right? Compared with 1969, computing has become unimaginably powerful. And it's in the hands of kids right now. And we're now in for an even bigger change. Right, let me hint at that. Right, one of my favorite app inventor examples, which many of you have seen, is this little project, this little program, right, which we can do as an intro app inventor project, which is a little app that you speak into in English and it says it back in Russian. Right, so how does it work, right? So you can see that when I click on the button, tell the speech recognizer to recognize my speech. When the speech recognizer has done that, tell the Yandex translator to translate that text into Russian. And when the translator has come back, take that and send it to text-to-speech. See, that was a research project 10 years ago. And now it's something that you can do in an introductory app inventor class. Right, and what's that? It's not just that the phone itself is a powerful computer. It's that this particular powerful computer in your pocket is connected to some of the most powerful computers in the world today, through the use of web services and APIs and places like speech recognition and speech generation and language translation, which are using amazingly complex services even for today. But they're all accessible to us and they're all accessible to kids. Right? What was a research project 10 years ago is a kid's exercise today. So let's all ask ourselves throughout this weekend, as you go back and think about it, what are the things that are ambitious enough to be research projects today that we think kids ought to be able to do in 10 years or 5 years or 2 years or maybe next year? What are they? Well, they're research projects today. But just as a little example, as a hint that even just came out last week, is Google just announced a computer vision API. Right? So no one's in app inventor's done this yet, but I bet somebody could, as a project, over the summer, create some kind of block where kids' programs can do visual recognition. And not only a little bit of visual recognition, but the very most sophisticated vision recognition in the world. That'd be a great project for somebody to do. How about, you saw that speech, that language instruction, that language recognition thing. It's parsing. Google's just announced a wildly impressive and a wildly powerful machine learning-based parser. Which again, nobody's hooked up to App Inventor yet, but you could. Imagine doing the most complicated level of textual understanding stuff today and turning it into, you could, something that you could make next fall. And of course, the B is the Internet of Things. So all of the stuff that we've been talking about in the information world is no longer just in the information world. It's that every single thing can participate in this information structure. And again, all of it can be accessible to kids. Projects. You'll see some examples. We're working on that in App Inventor. Andrew, we'll see a lab. Was it tomorrow? This afternoon?
This morning?
Okay. This morning, you'll have a chance to go over and play with some of that stuff. So, all of this stuff is making an enormous change. And it's just waiting for us to play with it. And what you can expect is that this change is going to be as large, maybe larger, as the mind-blowing progression that's already happened from something like Logo to where we are today. Can we be bold enough to say, even today, that the most powerful computing in the world should be something that's for kids? Logo Project said that in 1969, and it came true. Can we make that come true again? Can we work together to make that happen? I think we can. So let's all share over the next 3 days. Think about what we've achieved together, but remember that this is only
started to